Hi, everybody. It's good to see each of you. We've been praying about this teaching, so I hope you find it helpful, encouraging, even an exhortation this morning. Now, I'm going to talk to you about, on the eve of the election, how King Jesus is my president, and I hope that you will share that sentiment with me. We're going to talk about what that means and how to get there. But before that, I need to just address a couple of things from a pastoral sense of with the church. I guess all of this is pastorally, but specifically there's some items I want to talk to you about. The first is that we are going to send out an email to the church this week, so make sure we have your email address. And we're going to remind everybody about our posture as a church. The article is actually published on renew.org, and it's entitled The Romans 14 Posture as a Guide. It said originally to reopening, but it still is the basis by which we're operating as a church during COVID-19. Now, let me just try to describe reality as best I can right now. So COVID-19, as of yesterday, possibly today, has gone over 1,000 new cases in a day, which is a lot. So over 10 days, that's a million people in the U.S. getting COVID-19. We also know that the death rate is going up. It's over 1,000 again. And so it's the kind of thing that we want to take note of. But I want you to, as you take note of it, to note the posture that the elders of this church that we have taken. And I just want to reiterate it again for everyone, because we want to do all we can to protect the health of everybody who's a part of the church, but also allow freedom for differences in conviction. So the three principles that we follow are we provide an online option. Many of you are watching our services now online, and we plan to continue to do that. We also provide online Zoom groups. So let me take one example. We have one of our elders is Ed Kaiser. He's a very high at-risk category. And so for the sake of his health and his family, he's not attending services. And we're really grateful he's doing that, because we love Ed and we don't want Ed to be in danger, because he's in that at-risk category. Now, for those who are watching online, we think it's really important that you watch online every Sunday and that you get a part of an online group, because we care about you. We want to nurture you. The second group would be those who come to church and you have convictions about wearing a mask. So what we do as a church, our policy is threefold. I call it the three W's. When you walk in, our staff will be wearing a mask. Some of us will keep wearing a mask throughout the service, like me. even when I'm singing and all that, I'm going to wear a mask. So the three W's are you have the option to wear a mask, wash your hands, and walk 6 feet apart for social distancing. Others of you have a conviction not to wear a mask, and we honor that. So one of the things that's really hard to do, if you're a strong masker or if you're a strong no masker, it's really hard to say the church is going to allow both of us to function together. And it's what we call a third bucket issue. It's not an essential thing. It's not a scripturally important thing. It's a third bucket issue. And good Christian disciples of Jesus are going to disagree with each other. And so we are a church in third bucket issues, described in Romans 14. We allow people their own freedom of conscience. And I just want to say, the stronger you believe about a mask or no mask, it's really important that you realize that we allow one another the freedom to make our choices about that. And when we come together, for people like myself, I don't want to get COVID-19 because of lung conditions and so forth. I'm going to wear a mask. And if you don't, I'm fine with you. I've got my mask on. Okay? So we just want to have an environment where all those options are possible. So I'm in a small group because we're a church that meets Sunday morning and from house to house. My small group is a Zoom group because we have people who have health concerns and they're not able to join in person. Now, is that my first choice to be a Zoom group? I'm probably like you. I'm like zoomed out, okay? I would way sooner get together. If I were a 1-0 vote for me only, I would sooner get together than be in a Zoom group. But for people I love, I'm happy to do a Zoom group because I want them protected and I want them engaged in the Word of God. Listen, we have to help each other during this time. And all the experts are saying things are going to get worse over the next few months until there's a vaccine. Like, I'm rooting for the vaccine and because I think that it can help us to move ahead with getting back to normal. But the people that I know who know what they're talking about say that that's going to be a while before we can go back to normal. So let me just pastorally tell you something I am concerned about. We know from studies that were done months ago that a third of all church attendees have gotten disconnected from church since COVID-19 started. 33% in the U.S. of people are disconnected. So that's a concern for all of us who love one another and love the kingdom of God, because a lot of people are barely watching on Sundays and they're not in groups. And I just want to say, especially for the infants, spiritual infants and spiritual children, that's a concern. And I want to exhort all of us, let's do all we can to help people be engaged in church in the best way that they can. And let's encourage everybody to be here on Sunday, either online or in person, and be in a group either online or in person. Because too much is at stake in terms of our spiritual lives and health, and we do not want to abandon or forsake the assembling of ourselves together as the Bible commands in Hebrews chapter 10. Does everybody agree with that? I sure hope you do agree with it, because it's going to take all of us encouraging all of us, reaching out to one another to help us to be faithful to Jesus as we make these choices, which I hope that makes more sense to you in terms of our posture as a church. Now, the second thing I wanted to talk about is I wanted to talk to you about the decision that the leadership has made where we call people to fast and pray, typically on Mondays. This week it's not on Monday, it's on Tuesday, and Tuesday night at 7:30, either online or in person, right here, we're going to have a prayer meeting. We're going to pray for our nation. We're going to pray for the best for this nation. We're going to pray that God has his way with this nation. So I hope that you will take time, even if it's just one meal, on Tuesday to fast and pray for the church. So speaking of the election, and speaking of politics, I want to share some things with you this morning that I think God wants me to share with you. So let me start with a word of prayer. Can we pray? Lord God, we come to you this morning, and I pray for our people, your people here at Harpeth Christian Church, in person or online. God, we pray for a vision that Jesus is King of Kings and Lord of Lords, that the kingdom of God expressed through the local church is the most important political reality for every one of us. God, help us to see from Scripture that this is what you teach. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to just start off by saying that God taught the people of Israel a long time ago a lesson that's really important today. And here's what God taught the Israelites. He taught them that any human government is going to disappoint you and let you down. Here's how he taught them that. Around 1050 BC, 1,050 years before the time of Christ, the Israelites called out to God and said, "We want a king. All the other nations have a king. Lord, we want a king." God said, "No, you don't need a king." But the people said, "No, no, no, we want a king." God said, "Okay, I'm going to give you a king, but you're going to regret that you got a king." "Lord, we won't regret it. Please give us a king." He said, "Okay, I'll give you a king." So the first king in Israel was King Saul. And he started fairly well. Somewhere around 1040 BC, he started off to reign. And at first it looked good, and then it went bad. Saul was a bad king. So God said to Samuel, "I'd like you to go to Jesse, and Jesse has a son. I'd like you to anoint him the king of Israel." Samuel went to Jesse, and all of his sons came before the prophet Samuel, and the Lord said, "None of these boys will be the king of Israel." To which Samuel said to Jesse, "Do you have another son?" "Well, yeah, but he's only a young lad. They're around Bethlehem watching the sheep." Samuel said, "Bring him to me." So he brought him to him, and the Lord said, "This is the one I have chosen to be king of Israel," and his name was David. Now David was the king that is the epitome of a good king in Israel. He has the singular distinguishing epitaph that he was a man after God's own heart. So he was a great king. He's the one, by the way, that defeated Goliath. He's the one that defeated all the enemies of Israel. He's the one that God was so pleased with him when he asked God, "Can I build a temple for you?" That just pleased God. I'm going to show you that in just a second. But I want you to know, as good of a king as he was, he did bad things. He's the one that had the affair with Bathsheba. He's the one that had the army basically kill Bathsheba's husband so that he could take her for himself. Yeah, that was the king of Israel. That was the man after God's own heart. Here's the reality, friends. I don't care who they are. If they are a human being, they are going to fall short. They are going to politically disappoint us. And whatever policies, whatever kingdom they implement, it will not be the kingdom of God. So here's how it works. David came to God and he said, "Lord, you're so good to me. Here I am. I have a palace. You should have a palace, God. I want to build a temple for you. God, I don't want you to have to keep living in that tent where we make sacrifices. I want to build a temple for you." And so I'm out on a ledge. I don't remember who it was that came to him. And he said this, must be Samuel, because it's 2 Samuel chapter 7, came to David and gave the vision of God to David. By the way, if anybody remembers, help me to make sure we get... Nathan, thank you. Some people think I'm smart, and I know I'm really not. So this is what Nathan said to David. "The Lord declares to you that the Lord himself will establish a house for you. You want to establish a house for me? No way," God says. "When your days are over and you rest with your ancestors, I will raise up your offspring to succeed you, your own flesh and blood, and I will establish his kingdom. He is the one who will build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever." David says, "I want to build a house for you, physical house." God says, no. "I'm so pleased with you. I'm going to build a spiritual house through you and a kingdom that will never come to an end." He goes on in Ezekiel. So this is 550 years later. God, through the prophet Ezekiel, talks about this kingdom. And he literally uses the name David, who's been dead for 500 years. Here's what God says. "My servant David will be king over them," talking about the restoration of God's people. "And they will have one shepherd. They will follow my laws and be careful to keep my decrees. David, my servant, will be prince forever." What? David's coming back. He's going to come back and be prince forever. "I will establish them and increase their numbers, and I will put my sanctuary among them forever." Revelation 21 coming up right there. "My dwelling place will be with them. I will be their God, and they will be my people." So God said, "Hey, I know that you like kingdoms, and I know that you like kings. I'm going to establish a kingdom that will last forever." So when Jesus comes and he starts his public ministry in 26 AD, and they announce, repent, the kingdom of God is at hand. That's what Jesus says. Repent, the kingdom of God is at hand. This is Jesus the Messiah. That's what the name Jesus Christ means. It's like Jesus Christ, that's not his first name and last name. In the first century, it would have been Jesus, son of Joseph, Jesus of Nazareth. That's how they would have spoken of him. Instead, it's Jesus Messiah. Christ means Messiah. Jesus Messiah, and Messiah is king. So it's literally Jesus the King or King Jesus. He's the one. This man's claiming to be King Jesus. This is the one claiming to be the Messiah, the long-promised Messiah of God's people. How all the leaders in Israel ultimately let the people down. And so God promises to restore everyone. And it's going to be through Jesus, he says. And so they say, okay, if you're the Messiah, where's the kingdom? Once being asked by the Pharisees when the kingdom of God would come, Jesus replied, the kingdom of God is not something that can be observed, nor will people say, here it is or there it is, because the kingdom of God is in your midst. So the kingdom of God comes in Jesus. It's a kingdom that starts like a mustard seed because it's a spiritual kingdom initially. It's when God translates us, in the words of Colossians, from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. It's when God places his Holy Spirit within people so that God reigns and rules them. The kingdom has been inaugurated. Jesus showed what the kingdom was going to be because he healed the sick. He raised the dead. He healed the lepers. He walked on water. He showed that ultimately he is the king and his kingdom will transcend all physical life as we know it, but not yet. Because Jesus returned after his death, burial, and resurrection. He was exalted by God as King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and he's currently reigning and ruling through the Holy Spirit, through God's presence amongst us. But in the meantime, he's given us a mission. And notice how he sets up the mission that he's given to you and to me. Jesus came to them. This is on the mountain. This is in anticipation of his exaltation. Then Jesus came to them and said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. So I just want to say this. Who has all authority on heaven and earth? Do the demons that plague and bother us? No, Jesus has authority over them. All authority on heaven and earth has been given to Jesus. So under his authority, when he says to us, go and make disciples, to know his teachings and follow his teachings, what are we doing? We are taking the authority of King Jesus into our lives. We're letting him reign and rule us, which is what his kingdom is. He reigns and rules over us, so we follow his laws. We follow his commandments. We love one another as he teaches us to love one another. And we become the distinct people of God who know the Messiah and who are anticipating his return. Therefore, on the day of Pentecost, the day that the gospel was proclaimed for the first time, we see what happens. Here's how it works. They're all there, the Jewish people. One of the top three times Jewish people came to Israel or to Jerusalem, the day of Pentecost, Peter stands up and he says this. This is the climax of the sermon. He's giving them, explaining God's plan. He says, therefore, let all of Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah. Now, we're so used to those words, they can lose their meaning. Lord means he's God. That's a word, kurios. It's a word for God. It's not just like he's really important. He's important like in the sense that God's important. And Messiah means he's the king. He's the long-promised king. He's the one that would take care of us. He's the one that we could trust in. He's the one whose laws should be implemented and followed. He's the one who will ultimately redeem us and give us the life we all long for. He is the ideal political leader because everything that we aspire to and we desire in political leaders, peace, prosperity, good times, security, everyone's taken care of, nobody's in trouble. He is that political leader. because he's fully human and he's fully God. He's Lord of lords. He's King of kings. And they got it because you can see their reaction. When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, what should we do? It's like they were saying, they were realizing, hey, there's a lot of things you can think of in life. There's a lot of political entities. There's a lot of leaders. There's a lot of ways. There's a lot of rules. There's a lot of policies. But the only thing that matters is, who is the King of kings and the Lord of lords? Because that's the one I want to follow. The people were cut to the heart and they realized they got it. And so they responded. And their primary thing they did, when they repented and they were baptized in his name and received the Holy Spirit, is they pledged allegiance to King Jesus. Their primary identifying mark is their allegiance to King Jesus, which is part of how the word faith is understood in the Bible. It's to trust and follow, it's faithfulness, and it is allegiance to King Jesus. Now, I'd like to talk to you about how they understood that. So, in 1 Peter, Peter is writing to a group of Christians in, it's modern-day Turkey, it used to be Asia Minor. And he's writing to them, and there's just a small, fragmented group. But he wants them to understand their identity. And so he says this, but you, writing to the church, you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, and a holy nation. God's special possession. What he said to them, it's true of you and me. Did you know that? When you look around this room with me, look around the room and can we read this together? Because we're reading it about one another. Ready? But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession. That's who we are. This is the single most important identity that any human being can ever have. He goes on and says, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you'd not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. He goes on. Actually, before I talk about what he says, I just want to talk about this. Here's the right way to think of politics. The church is God's primary political body. The local church. That's where God's kingdom ways. That's where the leadership of King Jesus is exalted. God's ways, where we live differently than the world, where we hold one another accountable to the teachings, laws, and commandments of King Jesus. It's a community where love prevails. The greatest hallmark God wants to distinguish us is that we love one another as Jesus loves us. It's the only political reality, catch this, it's the only political reality, and it is a political reality in the face of all other political realities. It's the only political reality that deals with our true problems, our deepest needs, our sin, our estrangement from God, our problem with death, our destination apart from King Jesus, where we're going to hell, and King Jesus rescues us. It's the only entity that proclaims and upholds and lives in light of the gospel, which is the central thing in all of history. It's the gospel of King Jesus that makes us right with God and sets us into his kingdom. And so you say, hey, we're waiting for election results on Tuesday. I can understand that. There's merit to that. But let me tell you what I wait for more than the election on Tuesday. The return of King Jesus to fully establish his kingdom. And so we pray, our Father who is in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Here's how, I want to get to this slide in just a second. Here's how John described what's going to happen. King Jesus is coming back, and he's going to fully consummate and bring forth all the things of the kingdom of King Jesus that were promised in the Old Testament that we build our lives and hopes around. Here's how it's going to look. John says, I saw heaven standing open, and there before me was a white horse. So this description by John is going to take all the imagery of the prophetic and apocalyptic literature in Ezekiel, in Daniel, in Zechariah, all these images from the Old Testament that the people of God back then understood, and he's going to describe the return of Jesus with all this imagery. And so he says, I saw heaven open, and before me was a white throne whose rider is called Faithful and True. With justice, he judges and wages war. It's political victory. He sees political victory. He will defeat the kingdom of Satan and establish fully the kingdom of God. His eyes don't treat him as Jesus meek and mild. When he comes back, it's not Jesus meek and mild as a baby. It's the returning Lord of Lords and King of Kings. His eyes are ablaze like fire, and on his head are many crowns. He has a name written on him that no one knows but he himself. He is dressed in a robe dipped in blood, and his name is the Word of God. This is the Lord Jesus returning. Armies of heaven were following him, riding on white horses and dressed in fine linen, white and clean. They're made clean by the blood of Jesus Christ shed for our sins. Coming out of his mouth is a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations. The imagery taken from the book of Isaiah. He will rule them with an iron scepter. He treads the winepress of the fury of the wrath of God Almighty. On his robe and on his thigh, he has this name written. Say it with me. King of Kings and Lord of Lords. That's what I'm looking forward to. That, compared to Tuesday, makes Tuesday nothing. Now, let me show you this picture of him. So I met a few years ago a woman who felt led by the Holy Spirit to create all these images of the book of Revelation. It was really cool. And this is the scene we have just read about. And so you have this magnificent image. By the way, in Lord of the Rings, some of this imagery is, if you watch carefully, is referenced. By the way, on his thigh, I hate to say this, but it's true, there's a tattoo. Now, you're going to have to work that out in your own home, okay? Now, let's talk about the political realities that we face. Actually, let me share this with you, because we already referenced the promise in Ezekiel and the future that I look forward to. You know, every political part, I started out before I became a follower of Jesus, I was a political science major. I grew up in Canada, so I wanted to be the Prime Minister of Canada. I'm just saying, I did, okay? And then I decided that, like, why settle for politics when the kingdom of God is the reality that matters behind everything, okay? So for me, it was like a calling by God. Don't focus on secondary things. Now, I do think we need to appoint politicians who will uphold the values of King Jesus. I'll come back to that in just a second. But this is the vision of the book of Revelation when the political philosophy of King Jesus is reality. It's not a pipe dream. It's not a policy on the books. It's not a position paper. It's not something they say they're going to do. King Jesus will bring this about because he's fully human and fully God. He's King of Kings. He's Lord of Lords. And when he reigns in all of his fullness, this is what it'll be like for us. And I heard a loud voice from the throne of God saying, describing it, look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell among them. When Jesus returns as King of Kings and Lord of Lords, he judges humanity, and those who trusted and followed Jesus, he takes them to be with him. We will be together with our King Jesus, and this is our reality. They will be, we will be his people. And God himself will be with them and be their God. And he will wipe every tear from our eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. Does anybody know a better political vision than that one? It answers death. It answers sin. It answers all my fears, all my desires, and all of our hopes. It's drawn directly from Ezekiel 37. If you notice how it ends, it says, I will put my sanctuary among them forever. Carefully read Revelation 21. That's what he's describing. My dwelling place will be with them. I will be their God, and they will be my people. That, friends, is what it means to know and follow King Jesus. Now, let me address this temporary world that doesn't know the political entity of a biblical church and a biblical kingdom and the King of Kings. We still live in that world and we want to influence that world. And I want to say something that I feel like the Lord would want me to say to all of us. So I'm going to go back and I want to show you what I think is the single most important summary that I could give you about our nation. So if you go back to the year 2010, you will find that the number of people who claim to be practicing Christians is somewhere in the neighborhood in 2009, 2010. Notice it's at about 47%. Now watch this graph, the number in our country who claim to be practicing Christians, so that before COVID-19, notice it drops to 25% of the country. Now, I'm not saying that these people who claim to be practicing Christians are in fact practicing Christians, but I will tell you this, that their aspiration of saying, I'm a practicing Christian, is an important statement in the culture in which we live. Brooke Hempel, who's part of the Barna Group, who headed up this study, told me that is a earth-shattering statistic and reflection of the culture of the nation in which we live. So here's what I believe the Bible teaches, is that we are to be this people who live in allegiance to King Jesus. We advocate for the ways of King Jesus. We don't impose them on the world. They are upheld in the church. And to the rest of the world, we live out this life of love, this life of surrender to King Jesus. And we want to influence our world with the love and the holiness of God. And so we advocate primarily, as followers of King Jesus, the policies and principles that would best honor King Jesus. But the less we do that, the less strength we have, the more other philosophies and ideologies and political views will gain hold in our society. And we're seeing that happen now. I want to give you just a couple of examples. We published an article. Michelle Eagle, who's on staff here, wrote the article through Renew, which comes out of Harpeth Christian Church, and we found out that Facebook started suppressing publications by Renew.org because this was not politically correct. We appealed it and we asked them why, and all they would say is, we're not changing it, you violated our policy. When we asked them what policy we violated, they did not answer. This is what happens in a world where other beliefs and political allegiances become strong. I think John Piper wrote an article that many of you have read. It's an article that I had to pray through. I think the article is wrong in its ultimate advocacy, but I believe he says something that is really right that I wanted to share with you. Here's what he says. May I suggest to pastors that in the quietness of your study, you do this. Imagine that America collapses. First anarchy, then tyranny from the right and the left. Imagine that religious freedom is gone. What remains for Christians is fines, prison, exile, and martyrdom. Then ask yourself this: has my preaching been developing real radical Christians? Now, I wish he would have said, because it makes it look like it's all up to a pastor, and that's just not true. The church is about a discipling community. The pastors and elders are very important, but everybody's important. What he's about to describe, it's all of our job, because we are a kingdom of priests, we're a holy nation, and we call each other to allegiance to King Jesus. But here's what he said. Are we creating Christians who would sing on a scaffold before they die? Let goods and kindred go, this mortal life also. The body they may kill, God's truth abideth still. His kingdom is forever. He goes on and he says, here's the question. Christians who will act like the believers in Hebrews 10:34, who joyfully accepted the plundering of their property, since you knew that you yourselves, he's quoting from Hebrews, had a better possession and abiding one. Piper says this: Christians who will face hate and reveling and exclusion for Christ's sake, and yet rejoice in that day and leap for joy, for behold, your reward is great in heaven. Quoting Jesus about persecution. I wish I had more time to dive into this deeply. I believe that we're seeing the emergence of a new religion. It's not called religion, but it's a new religion. It goes by the name sometimes, are you woke? Are you politically correct? Do you really get it? Or are you a misogynist, a homophobe, a racist, a hateful, socially backward person who doesn't live for social justice? It's an entirely different worldview that has religious overtones. If you want to know more about it, there's a book called Cynical Theories: How Activist Scholarship Made Everything About Race, Gender, and Identity, and Why This Harms Everybody. The answer to all of these things is for Christians to follow King Jesus, to be allegiant to him, and for the church to be the church. So when we look at our culture, we say government is not the answer to spiritual and cultural issues. We look at our world and we say the world is adopting views of life that have no plan for death, that assume human beings can create meaning for themselves without reference to God, and then we will overrate government, we will overrate policies, we will overrate politicians, and we don't realize that all of this is just as bad as the Israelites who said to God, "We don't want you, God, we want our own king." There is only one king. Now, in a democracy, it is our responsibility to vote for those who are most aligned with the values of King Jesus. But any president, to the right or to the left, is going to disappoint us. And they will not address our most fundamental problems: alienation from God, our propensity to pride, sin in our lives and those around us, and its consequences, and most importantly, the biggest problem human beings ever face is that we die and face a Christless eternity separated from God. And so we say, only Jesus is our king. Only Jesus answers our biggest longings and our deepest problems. I'd like to ask if the ushers would come forward at this time. You know, when Jesus instituted the Lord's Supper, he had this kingdom vision with his disciples, even though they didn't fully understand it. Here's what was going on. He was trying to tell them that in his person, King Jesus deserved their primary allegiance. King Jesus deserves your primary allegiance. It's like he's totally worthy. King Jesus deserves your primary identification. You're not a Republican. You're not a Democrat. You're a follower of King Jesus. You don't let politics on the right define Jesus or politics on the left define Jesus. You let Jesus define politics on the right, politics on the left, because allegiance and loyalty to Jesus the King is the most important ideology and loyalty we can have. King Jesus is our primary focus and our hope. King Jesus is the one who deserves our lives, our best efforts, our giving, our gifts, everything that we have, everything that we are, everything that will be. We surrender joyfully to King Jesus, who is Lord of Lords and King of Kings. And one day we will all bow before him and he will say to his children, "Well done, good and faithful servants. Come and share in your master's happiness." So when they took communion, Jesus passed out the bread and then he passed out the cup. And I'm going to tell you what he said before this line, but I'd like you to think about this line recorded in the Gospel of Luke. Jesus said, "Whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Because we are pledging allegiance to the political reality that will transcend all political realities. In the words of Daniel chapter 2, it is the stone that breaks all other stones. It is a kingdom that will never end. So if you would, please, take the bread. Thank you. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took the bread, and after he broke it, he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take and eat. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's eat the bread. In a similar fashion, after the supper, he took the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, given for the forgiveness of your sins. Drink this in remembrance of me." Let's pray. Would you please stand? King Jesus, we stand as people so grateful. We are so grateful that you have forgiven our sins. We're so grateful that you've given us a kingdom, that you reign in our hearts. Oh, King Jesus, we want you to reign more fully. King Jesus, we pledge allegiance to you. We pledge allegiance to you above all politics. You are our King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We trust you. We look forward to the consummation of your kingdom, when heaven and earth will all be transformed, where heaven and earth become one, and you dwell amongst us. You make us the sacred dwelling place of God. We look forward to your return. We look forward to you telling us how you've forgiven us of all of our sins, and you invite us to experience the fullness of your kingdom in time that will not end, and we are so grateful in anticipation of that day. We pray this in your name, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.